Hey, greetings from Berkeley, California. I am thrilled to be a moderator for this electrifying conversation on queer and feminist movements against dictatorship in Thailand between Thai queer activist Sirapop Attohi, or Raptor, and historian of Thai gender and sexuality, Professor Tamara Luz. My name is Thiti Jamkhachorn Kiat, a PhD candidate in South and Southeast Asian Studies at UC Berkeley and the academic chair of the US-based Association for Thai Democracy, or ATD. I wish to thank the Center for Southeast Asia Studies for agreeing to host this event out of solidarity. If you are interested in the ATD's cause and projects, please consider visiting our website and following our social media accounts, which I'll be posting in the chat box. As there is not yet a major political eruption since the last Thai talk earlier this month, let me remind the audience about the Thai state's violence against the protesters by recounting some basic figures. Since the first Assembly of Free Youth, or Yawachon Pot Ek, in July 18th last year, until September 30th this year, 15 months of protracted protest, data from the Thai Lawyers for Human Rights shows that there are already 1,458 people in 484 cases have faced lawsuit for their political participation and expression. To highlight specific social groups, from 1,485 people, 58 people, there were 223 youth under 18 years old, 328 women, and 41 members of the LGBTQ plus community. In September alone, last month, 269 people were detained for participating in protests, including at least 18 children of below 15 years old and at least 60 youth between 15 to 18 years old, with the youngest being 12 years and 4 months old. Yes, you hear it right, 12 years and 4 months old. Beside the emergency decree and usual legal charges, there were 21 new lèse majesté cases in September in a country where this law has been the world's harshest. After listening to depressing figures, allow me to bring you to a more hopeful occasion by introducing our two panelists. Sirapop Attohi, or as we have nicknamed in Thai, Raptor, is Thai queer feminist and anti-dictatorship activist. They are a co-founder of two radical pro-democracy collectives based in Bangkok. First is Seri Thai Plus, a queer protester collective demanding gender equality and democracy. Second is Mob Fest, a collective weaponizing media in a hegemonic battle to promote a democratic culture. Being a part of these two groups allows Raptor to wield queer culture against the intersected oppressive forces of militarism and patriarchy. Aside from leading protests, in their free time rather, they are a senior in drama and theater at Chulalongkorn University. Tamara Luz is professor of Southeast Asian history at Cornell University, where she is also chair of the history department. Her most recent book, Bones Around My Neck, published in 2016, offers a critical history of Siam during the era of high colonialism through the dramatic and tragic life of a pariah prince, Prisadang Chumsai. Her teaching and articles focused on an array of topics, including sex and politics, subversion and foreign policy, sexology, transnational sexualities, comparative law, sodomy, and gender in Asia. She has been interviewed by the BBC, the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Financial Times, and other global media outlets about political protests in Thailand. In my undergraduate time at Chulalongkorn, where Raptor is also currently studying, me and my friends called her the Wame Gender, or the master of the study of gender, which I think is not an exaggeration. No one is better equipped to comment on long history of Thai sexuality than her. This talk is structured as the following. Raptor and Professor Luz will each give a brief presentation for 15 to 20 minutes. Afterwards, both panelists will comment on each other's presentation and have an unmoderated conversation with one another for 15 to 20 minutes. Then we open the floor up for Q&A until the event ends. During and after the talk, feel free to post your question or comments in a separate Q&A box. Please also specify your current affiliation in your post. So now, Raptor, if you are prepared, the screen is yours.
Hello, everybody. Good morning. Oh, in Thai time, my name is Raptor Sirapop Attohi. I'm a protester and activist in gender equality and against dictatorship. But first, before beginning my presentation, I would like to shout out from my friends in who was arrested in jail. First, Penguin Parichivarak, more than 2 months. Pai Jatupat Bunyapat Daksa, more than 2 months. Anon Nampa, more than 2 months. Huat, about a month. Atit Talufa, for a month. Chitipat, for a month. Mai Panupong, for a month. Nat, which is 16 years old, about 1 month. Nawapon, about half of a month. Wachirabit, half of a month. Bawarit, half of a month. Suksan, half of a month. Paitun, half of a month. Benja, for about half of a month. The protester at Dindang for about two weeks, and finally for Yajai has been arrested yesterday. Okay, this is what can I do for my friends and for the international friends to help us and shout out for our friends and situation in Thailand right now. Okay, today I'm going to speak about the queer and feminist movement against dictatorship in Thailand. Okay, on the surface, the movement in this wave from the last year 2020 to 2021, and the movement in this wave have a woman and queer LGBTQIA+ community as the leading activist. I personally have involved in the several protests, which I think they are influenced by the idea of feminism and queer movement. I myself also organized and contribute to the several queer and feminist movement in Thailand. Okay, this is my group. This is which is Seri Thai Plus, or the free queer free gender in English, นะคะ. Okay, first I will today I will start with telling the story of the movement, and then I will explain the observation from my experience and my own perspective inside the movement. Okay, we can see in the presentation there's prioritizing democracy first. This is the sentence that some activists or pro democracy people often say before this. They always say to the group or the movement that that's based on the certain identity, especially like gender movement or something like that. It says that they said that instead of fighting for your own matter or your own specific movement, we should prioritizing fighting for democracy first, and after that, after we win, after we get the democracy, you can fight for the specific issue. So in my opinion, this sentence reflects on the lack of understanding and attention to the on the issue that the various of identity have faced have faced this differently, such as gender, such as labor, or so on. But however, I think queer and feminist movement in Thailand has proven this wrong. Fighting, I think fighting for democracy and fighting with dictatorship and fighting with patriarchy can go well together, as we're gonna see. I'm gonna show you here. Okay, before we step up to the protest, I would like to mention one movement or one phenomenon that happens in Thailand, which I think it influenced the Thai movement a lot. It is femtweet, which has come from the word feminist and Twitter. Okay, to be simple, femtweet are the feminists on Twitter advocating for gender equality, but they are not only against patriarchy, but they also against dictatorship. They have a manner which is not like so Thai manner at all, because they don't compromise or with norms or seniority. They are not trying to be polite. They are kinda like angry young woman, angry. Who have been oppressed for a long time, speaking out for equality and justice. I think this behavior have transferred to the main movement for democracy in Thailand. The demand are more straightforward and direct, instead of having to save face or compromise. Okay, in the early of 2000, okay, we are going to talk about the protests in Thailand. In the early of 2020, there is a dissolution of Future Forward Party. So it sparked the protest inside the universities in Thailand, throughout the country. In Chulalongkorn, which is my, which is I'm studying in this university, there is several protests too. I saw that the speakers or the organizers of the protest are women and LGBTQ, as you can see in the picture. This is Fleur and this is Alice, and yes, they are feminists. And they are call themselves femtweet too. Most of the protesters seem to be women than a men. Unfortunately, when the pandemic of COVID-19 occurred, the movement temporarily stopped. Okay. So in this picture is the July 18 protest, which is the beginning of the other protest follow. The femtweets who are accused for not coming to the protest and only speaking in the internet. The femtweet came on the road physically. They have shown themselves present of the protest. Interestingly, the sign that many protesters hold demand for various different issues, including marriage equality, but I cannot find the picture here. I'm so sorry. There is a sign in the protest too. In the picture, you can see that that the protester have write on their body is like this is femtweet, and like this. Okay. Also in July, there is my organized protest. I initiate and organize it with my friends. It named not a QC but Flamboyant Mobster, Mr. Government. It is one of the first protests that attempt to represent and create space for feminist and LGBTQIA plus community. And also one of the first protests that had a pride flag on the street. What we are trying to do after the protest in the mid-July is to connect the idea of fighting for gender oppression and fighting dictatorship together, meaning it can be demanded at the same time. During the speech, we emphasize the free demands of the movement, which were the main proposal at that time, including ending intimidating of the people, the dissolution of the house, and the new constitution. At that time, we bring the movement of the certain identity to join the movement and for basic principle. Another aspect that I think the protest has supported, many protests after this also try to take care to care for the safe space for the women and LGBTQIA+ people. Before, people trying to be anonymous on the street since the protest look dangerous. But in this protest. People can represent themselves as they are, and they can proud to be their own self. After this protest, many protest organizers discuss about the safe space for everyone to speak out and the system to support of the victim of the sexual harassment. Okay. This is the poster. To the left is the poster of the protest, and the second is the activists who dressed up themselves as they are to the protest. Okay. Next, I'm going to talk about the group of feminists named Women for Freedom and Democracy, and now. Later changed into Feminist Liberate to be more inclusive. This group nowadays is the main actor to push the feminism agenda in the protest. They speak about the fight against gender oppression in relation to fight against dictatorship at the same time. They are the main group today which are highly active to organize the political event and join in the protest and have influenced the movement a lot. First, on the 16th of August 2020, Women for Freedom and Democracy have debuted and spoke about gender equality on the stage. Many protesters have rainbow flags with them. So it's a sign for demanding of more equal rights for women and LGBTQ for an LGBTQ community. As you can see on her back, it's a pussy what democracy to is the fight back of the sentence that says democracy first and then gender equality after. In the 19 November 2020 is the protest organized by the Thammasat University Thammasat Student University so at Sanam Luang at Sanam Luang nowadays there is a demand for the change of the the monarchy at Sanam Luang Wat Dao, which is one of the activists in Feminist Liberate, has spoken about the oppression on women and monarchy. So and also they have a booth for advocating feminism idea, and for the people to sign a petition, proposing a law. There was also creating a safe space to take care for people who were sexual harassed at that day. Okay, this is Wat Dao Chumaporn, who briefly speak about the monarchy, and this is what we do at Sanam Luang. That day we have the pride flag on the floor and to be a dance floor, and everybody can dance into it. And also you can see the pride flag in the protest. Next, in October, in the November, our second protest. We call it a Pride Parade. Pride in Thai means the commoners, and also it's linked with the Pride Parade internationally. We organize the parade from Sam Yan, from Sam Yan to Si Lom, calling for democracy and and gender equality too. It is organized by our group, say Return Plus. And in this protest, you can see the various and different of the sign which calling for gender equality, such as this is the blood donation of accept the blood donation from the gay people or the trans women people. In Thai the Red Cross actually don't accept the blood donation from us, so we have calling for that, and there is also the marriage equality too. Okay, as I say that after the contribution of the feminist movement in Thailand, there is more activists who kinda open their gender identity and can show themselves in the public too. This is Penguin Parit Chivarak, who is the leader, one of the leader of the protester, and he right now was arrested and jailed for the Les Majestés law for 2 months right now, and this is the third time in this wave that he was arrested and put in the jail. You can see that Parit, which is my friend from the high school, dressed up in drag and show to the public and singing the folk song that the Thai folk song that criticized the monarchy. This has been interested and cheered from many protesters, and and the pink wig one is me. Okay, here we can see the group of Talufa wrapping the democracy monument with the pride flag in the pride flag, and you can see the red flag up there. The red flag up there is show have shown the demand of the people in Thai movement right now, which is first to get Prayut Chan Ocha, which is the dictator right now, resign. Second, to write a new to write the new constitution, and third, to reform the monarchy, and also they feminist liberation group collab and wrap up the democracy monument with pride flag. In the banner you can see they write is a hope and fighting of the people. So you here the feminist liberate group has okay in Thai protest there is a car mob which is using the car to protest the government, and the feminist liberate group has also joined in the caravans, and they call it Khabuan Ki or the Pussy Parade. Recently the Pussy Parade, which is organized by feminist liberate, have supported Pa Pao, Pa Pao naked protest. Here you can see Pa Pao or Aunt Pao. She get into naked against the fighting with the police, which is coming to harm the protesters. So she get into naked to fight and protest. And feminist liberate group have inspired by the action of this so much, so they get into the protest and supporting Pa Pao naked protest. So you can see in this picture, this is the caravan from Si Lom to Democracy Monument to have the protest there, and there is a drag queen who showed and entertained in the protest. But what's happening is before the protest have finished, the police come to crack down before we have the naked protest, and so it ends before we have naked. But the speech in the activity was mainly about gender and democracy, and also we speak up for we call out for the article 112 and we also talking about the monarchy too. Okay, while I have mentioned about the movement in public, there was also changes inside the movement or the activist and the organizer of the protest. Actually, there is some of the case of the sexual harassment in democracy movement. There is some of the sexual harassment in democracy movement, and I don't know whether it gets better or not. But what I can see is more people who get harassed speak out, and more people care and ask about this more, and there is more support to the victim of the sexual harassment than before, and we have the support system that can support the victim of the sexual harassed. So in the presentation, we can see that feminist movement in Thailand never leaves their own demands, and also they try to find the common ground with the main demands. We also do the things we call feminist practice and spread in the movement. First, we really care about the security and well-being of the protester and the organizer of the organizer of the protest, and what we are fighting. We were fighting with non-violent protest. As we pay the attention to the security first. Why we use the non-violent protest? Because we believe that the violence is the manner of dictatorship and representing of patriarchy, which is not safe for women and LGBTQIA+ community. to create the new society, there we need to create the safe space for everyone to be safe in the physically and mentally. So my main observation in the past 2 years of the protest and movement is that the reason why many feminist LGBTQ people stand up against dictatorship, why? Is because they're understanding the oppression, not only in the principle or theory level, but they faced we faced and feel the oppression in our life. We have faced the oppression of gender norms. We have oppression by the gender binary. So I believe that women and queer are the one who faced the oppression directly, and so they have we have to stand up and fight back the dictatorship and patriarchy. That and also I believe that we the women and queer people are the key to change the society. Also, we above all, nonetheless, we cannot overcome the gender stereotyping and or the gender binary in the protest. We can see that sometimes queer culture is famous in the protest, but also queer is to be funny in Thai culture. So sometimes we are getting to be the entertainer of the protest, and sometimes many leading activists cannot really come out as they are in publicly. But there's still a progress in the movement. As now we have more allies to support for gender issue in Thai society, and many people have right now is understanding how we get oppressed by the gender binary system and patriarchy. So I think it's going to get better and better in the protest, and we can right now imagine for the better society. That's all my experience in engaging in feminist and queer movement in Thailand. Thank you
so much, Raptor. Thank you really for your presentation that give us the overview of what is happening in terms of feminist and queer movements against dictatorship in Thailand. There are also lots of gender and sexuality specific tactics and counter discourses deployed in various protests. I'm sure there are so much to be in conversation later with Professor Liu's. And without further ado, we now proceed to Professor Liu's brief presentation.
All right, hold on here. I do not have a PowerPoint. I'm going to save you from that, and I'll try to make this quick. But first, I want to thank Tithi and the Association for Thai Democracy for inviting me. I'm honored to be here. I also want to thank members of the Center of the South for Southeast Asian Studies at Berkeley and Sarah for publicizing this and helping us out. And finally, of course, I want to thank Raptor. I'm so excited to meet you, and for everybody who's listening to us right now, whether it's very late or very early. So I would like to highlight a crucial but underemphasized aspect of the protests and their political ethics. And I'll just sidebar here and say that a lot of what I have to say, Raptha has already mentioned, and so there's quite a bit of overlap, and I hope that'll be all right. But this crucial but underemphasized aspect of the protests is the centrality of queer and women's voices and bodies. Lots of bodies in those images. What's so often highlighted in the news are demands for political change that are not on the face of it specifically about gender or sexuality. And Rapha mentioned a few of these, like ousting Prayut, revising the constitution, reforming the monarchy, and the like. Many political commentators and scholars mention this, but they fail to discuss the fact that part of what fuels these demands is about gender and sexuality. They're not peripheral, they're not incidental to the more normative politics of the movement. Their protests are fundamentally challenging the value of social conformity that is at the foundation of the Thai status quo. And I think you saw quite a bit of that in Rappler's presentation. So I think that those political commentators who focus on the narrowly political really ignore this point at their peril. And I know I'm speaking to the choir here, but I do hope others find this evidence as convincing as I do. I don't think you can talk about the current monarch or the demonstrations we've seen since 2019 without discussing gender and sexuality. And the first piece of evidence is right before our eyes, and that's in the bodies of the demonstrators. There's a new inclusion of, a new ethics of inclusion at the protests that we haven't seen before in Thai political demonstrations. We see protesters advocating for disability rights, for labor rights, for women's rights, and LGBTQ plus rights. Their goal is political, yes, but they also embody another goal, and that's to expand the range of acceptable social norms regarding the body, gender, and sexuality. Protesters don't fit in, they don't conform, and the pressures placed on them to conform stem from a political culture that values hierarchy, with the monarchy at the center of it, and it's backed by the military and backed by a massive propaganda machine that curates public representations of the royal family. The demonstrations have become avenues for young people, not just to refuse royalism, but also to demand this right to nonconformity. And I know conformity is a valued characteristic of many cultures to some degree or another. And I think it's particularly valued in Thai culture, more so than in the US. It can be comforting to fit in, right? We all want to feel like we fit in. It's that sense of knowing one's place, maybe galatesa, not standing out, which is always uncomfortable, right? But this has become a straitjacket in Thailand where values are changing. The compulsion and pressure to obey social norms regarding gender, sexuality, status, hierarchy, actually obscure as normal or right a set of privileges that benefit some people over others. And I think what the protesters are doing very well is exposing these social norms for the hierarchy that it protects. They're demanding a more equitable system, and that's bigger than the more narrowly political demands to oust Prayut and put the king under the law. The protests, I think, are distinctive for several reasons, and some of these are really clear, and Rapha has already mentioned them. One is age and generational experiences. So unlike earlier protests, even in the 2010s, right, these protesters are mostly young people who grew up with a cell phone in their hands. I think that's a Chris Bakerism. And they've had access to a literal fire hose of data. Thai authorities, the army and the state broadcasting system no longer are the sole source of information. Instead, young people have access to multiple narratives about Thai history and the monarchy. So they don't have to swallow that normative narrative wholesale anymore. Young people also have access to protests and to lifestyles of young communities of like-minded people around the globe. So age is important. Also, Thai protests since 2019 are different in another way. They're led by women, gay men, and lesbians, in addition to the usual straight male leadership. An obvious contrast here is the red and yellow shirts, which were both led by heteronormative men. So we see this in the female leadership and the bodies of the protesters. Rappler mentioned that like 70% of the protesters, at least initially in the first year or two, were estimated to be female. This may have changed in the most recent protests. I'm obviously not in Thailand, so I can't check out and see who's there on the ground. You know, the leadership is still majority male, I think, across the board, but women are also powerfully vocal and present and not behaving according to proper femininity. We saw some great pictures a moment ago. I don't need to repeat that, but even protesters like Rung was up on stage reading the 10 demands drafted by students at Thammasat and refusing to use Ratchasat. So these outspoken women who refuse to submit to authority are doubly challenging social norms, gender norms, and status hierarchies. And my favorite example of this is the pussy painting organized by the group Women for Freedom and Democracy, which is at some of the protests. And I find this amazing as that picture of the naked woman you know, showing herself to the police, because in my experience, even in locker rooms, women don't undress in front of each other. So there's a strong value of modesty, especially when it comes to the body, that's just being thrown out the window here. The other difference I just want to point out, which was very clear in the presentation before me, is that the aesthetic of these protests is rainbow colored and campy in spirit. So Raptor organized a Gatoy mob. There are drag queens at lots of the protests. You see rainbow branding, like the Free Youth Movement symbol, at least it used to be, not just the three fingers hunger salute, but also was rainbow colored and was led by Ford, who was openly gay. You have gay men like Penguin, who dons dresses in his scathing satires. And so we just saw those images. So I'm glad I didn't make my PowerPoint. And the point here is that it's creative, it's innovative, it's colorful, but it's not just Sanuk, it's not just fun. It's part of the ethics and the aesthetics of a new generation who again demand this right to not conform. So the other thing I would just want to point out, which is the real substance of these movements, is that is their demands, right? So they don't just want a reform in the monarchy or the constitution or the current prime minister, but they want marriage equality. They want abortion rights. That's been a big deal out there. They want reforms in school uniforms and hairstyles so that those who are non-binary or those whose gender identity differs from their birth certificate can express their chosen gender and sexual identity rather than have a binary gender norm imposed upon them. They want an end to sexual abuse and harassment, especially by teachers, which is pretty important to point out. Female leaders have challenged the gatekeeping functions of Thailand's most powerful institutions, the M's, military, the monarchy, I would add the monkhood. They're all dominated by men and they have little place for women. So these are just some of the ways that the protesters are using gender and sexuality to draw attention to and critique hierarchy that's at the foundation of the current social and political order. The last thing that I want to say, and I see that we are getting short on time, is to just look a little bit at the question of why now. I think it's important to think about that because we see so many young people since the late 2010s stepping outside of their comfort zones and protesting sometimes daily. Raptor mentioned one of the catalysts, which was the dissolution of the Future Forward Party, and the disappearance of Wan Chalom is another reason. But I think that there's a deeper reason, and that is that the two coups that occurred as King Bhumibol grew weak, placed military generals in control of the polity, and relatedly, the ascension to the throne of King Wijiralongkorn. King Bhumibol reigned for a 70-year period during which Thailand became a relatively prosperous country. His image was carefully curated. You can read Ajahn Tak's book on the politics of despotic paternalism to learn a little bit more about the revival of the monarchy during that era. But King Bhumibol lived an ethical life, at least on the face of it, in the public eye. He did not live extravagantly. He was monogamous, married to one woman his entire life. And he behaved in a way that kind of reinforced an image of him as a benevolent and good king. He was morally irreproachable or close to it in the eyes of Thailand's population. Most of them found him worthy of respect, and some even found him worthy of a kind of worship. So there's a real strong contrast, right, to his son, who has a reputation for being unethical and unscrupulous in his public and private life. And we know, I could rattle off all the things you already know about what he did when he first became king, changed the constitution so he could reside in Germany, took control of the Crown Property Bureau, became the world's richest royal. You know, all of this is pretty harsh, given that it occurred at about the same time that the pandemic hit, and many Thais were suffering from economic hardship. But what I want to focus on is something that I think is a little bit more directly related to our talk today, and that's that in that time frame of 2019-20 that we see these protests explode, we also see King Vajiralongkorn resurrect the institution of polygyny on his birthday. He boldly broadcasted his appointment of Sini Nhat as his royal noble consort. Then he demoted her, after which she was disappeared. And the rumors for a while are she was in prison, maybe she had been killed by him. But then he snapped his fingers and reinstated her, quote unquote, without blemish. I'll just say that King Vajiralongkorn's misogyny is legendary, and his treatment of Sini Nhat has encouraged an understanding of him as viciously unethical in gendered ways. So I bring this up not to be gossipy or salacious, but to make a point. And that is that there's a relationship between the retrenchment and intensification of gender inequality and sexism in the activities of the monarch on the one hand, and the outpouring of support by women and those who promote gender and sexual diversity on the other. And I think that relationship has not been properly appreciated for its ability to catalyze and propel an engine motor activists to feed them, basically. The new generation's approach to and definition of democracy presumes a commitment to gender, sex and sexual diversity, in stark contrast to the political culture of the monarchy and status quo establishment, which is intensely patriarchal and male dominated. And I think this contrast is instructive and related. So those are my main points. And I would love to take questions and also ask Raptor what he thinks. And I have a few questions for him as well, but Titi, maybe I'll let you make the transition here.
Yes, absolutely. So thank you both panelists for your extremely erudite and thought-provoking discussion of the situation in Thailand. In a session afterwards, we will have both Raptor and Professor Luz comment on each other's presentations and have a conversation with one another rather informally to further explore many issues that have raised in both your presentations for perhaps 10 to 15 minutes, and afterwards we will take questions. How does that sound like?
That sounds fine to me. Raptor, maybe I can ask you a personal question, if you don't mind.
Okay, you can.
Well, a couple of questions. Can you tell us a little bit more personally about your role in the protests? And I'm curious about your experience at Priem Udon High School, because it seems like quite a few protesters have come from this particular
school.
And so I'm just curious what, you know, I know in one of your interviews you talked about how you weren't particularly political. You didn't think it had anything to do with you when you were in high school, but that started to change. So maybe you could talk us through that a little bit.
Okay, I will start with why, what I think why Priem Udon students have become more political active, and why some of the leader of the protest is the Priem Udon student. First, I think that in Thailand, they were so centralized at the capital in Bangkok, so the education in Thailand is very good at Bangkok, but very bad at in the province. So Priem Udon is one of the they call it one of the best school in Thailand, and yes, and also in Bangkok, and many of the students who attend in Priem Udon Siksa School is like upper middle class elite or the well educated student from other province and get in and attended into the high school. So I think that one of the thing that we have been experience there is the oppression of the system that oppressed the education system. Why Priem Udon have to why Priem Udon has a privilege to be a good school, and while the other school did not get the better education or the better teacher or the better chance to get into the university. So but this make the Priem Udon student more privileged than other students. So I think that we can see that before this Priem Udon Siksa student is not political active, and sometimes and before this in the coup of 2017, I guess 2000, I can't remember. Most of the Priem Udon Siksa students support the pro monarchy and support the coup. But the later years on, we can see that in that phenomenon, I think that it shows how elite the Priem Udon Siksa student is. And but also there is some of the student who didn't conform with the system, like Penguin is political active since the high school, and I am his friend since high school. He often invites me to his political activity. Sometimes I accept, and sometimes I was like, what did you do? Why did you do this? I can't understand. But when we get into the university, our experience is wide awake. I don't know what to say. Is more open minded and can see the oppression in the system more than in the theory. So I think this make some of the Priem Udon student realize that they are more privileged than others. So we have to give back to the society to make a better future as we are more privileged than the others. I think, but okay, some of the students are also ignorant nowadays. So, yeah, and okay, can I repeat the question?
Yeah, that helps. I was just curious if you know if you thought that there was something in particular about Triamudom that politicized students, whether it was because of how they enforced kind of nationalist norms, you know, or if it was actually a free place.
Yeah, and also the history of the of the school of the Triamudom, they always talk about the monarchy. They always talk about the elite, in the history of the founding of the school. So when we grow up and realize that the telling is not true, it's not actually true, so we can connect it with the monarchy system, which is influenced the country, and also like propaganda as to love or to think or to follow or believe, have faith in the monarchy. So I think that Triamudom student, like sometimes is also the history as is associated with the monarchy, and so when we grow up and realize more about politics, we can have the we can think that some of the norms has connected to the norms of the monarchy. So when we up against the norm, so we up against the history of the monarchy also.
Interesting. No, thank you for answering that. Okay, I have a, should I pause? Do you have a question for me, or I can keep asking you?
Okay, actually I feel very excited and honored to see you and have the conversation with you. I have no question right now, but I have to thank you for you to say about the like the sexual norm and gender norm or heteronormativity or something that that have influenced the movement, as we can see or cannot see something that there is a connection between the gender oppression and why women and queer stand up against dictatorship. As you said that there is a lot of the gender oppression in the monarch, and it made me realize that yeah, there are so many things that have sparked the conversation of to criticize the monarchy, and especially his sexual behavior that is not followed in the norm and actually that gossip of the previous queen Sininath is sparked a lot of in the gender oppression to get her head shaved, to be in the monkhood, and yeah, the gender oppression of the monarchy shown us that the system is very corrupted and is associated with many system many system in Thai that is very corrupted, such as military who is support the monarchy, and the monarchy support the military to coup or to have the power in his hand, and also the in the Buddhist religion also associate with this. Thank you for you making the connection connection of the why we stand up against patriarchy and and dictatorship, or and also asking for reforming of the monarchy. And yeah, and I think it is very important to like that telling this and connected this, because some of the activists did not see this connection, so they do not give an attention to the gender equality or the safe space for the sexual harassing in the movement.
Thank you for saying that, and I'm also very honored to meet you as well. I will ask you one more question, and then I have more, Titi, but I don't want to block other people out, so you just have to interrupt me. But I wonder, Rapa, if you can talk a little bit about fun or sunuk in your protest, right? Because I think one of the there's this interesting tension that you talk about. On the one hand, Gitoy, or queer people often have to occupy, especially I would say Gitoy, have to occupy the space of the comedian, somebody who is funny, and even at some of the protests, it is, parts of this are fun, right? It's campy and it's spirited, and it kind of sets up an opposition with activists who have to be serious and angry.
Yeah,
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the role of fun and drag at these protests for you all.
Oh, okay. So you have said something that associated with it. It is all the time in the protests in Thailand, or the movement against dictatorship in Thailand is male dominated, and have the leader, which is the heteronormative men. So we can see that the anger and aggressive manner is the main part of is the main part and the picture of the protest. So when it comes to this, I think women and LGBT, especially LGBTQ queer Gitoy community, can be connected with this feeling, because we have the incident of the massacre in the protest before, the Red Church massacre or something like that. So when it comes to the protest, some of the people feel like this is not it's not safe, it's dangerous, and we can die every moment, we can be shooted. So I think fun to make the protest sometimes fun or entertaining makes the safe space for young people, for women and LGBTQ people to think that the protest is not so dangerous. And and when it comes to like queer culture or feminist practice, it makes the safe space for women and LGBTQ community, so it embraces more of the it embraces more of the people to join in the movement. This is what I see, and I think sometimes fun makes the mockery of the authority. Like we use the element of funny things many times, such as in last year we have organized the like fashion show protest in the mockery of the CD1 Marie fashion show in Paris to criticize the monarchy, that they have used our text to make a fashion show her own. why the people are dying by COVID-19 and poverty. Why? So we have the funny element to mock the authority and to criticize the monarchy. And in our protest, the flamboyant mob, we use the queer culture from the movie Hotel Tag, which is Oh My Ghost in Netflix, to mock the pro monarchy or pro dictator people. They always said like us to get out of the country if we don't love our home. So so in the movie there is the conversation of the character said about this too. So we use this to mock back to the authority and also shown that this is so nonsense, and to fight back the discords of the pro monarchy or the pro dictator of the pro dictator people. Yeah, I think fun in so I think fun in the protest makes two points. First, to make the safe space for women and LGBTQ community to embrace more of the people to the movement. And second, it used as a weapon against dictator and monarchy and the gender norms and mockery of the authorities, I think.
Great answer. Thank you.
So I'm going to intervene and start to read out some of the questions in the Q&A box. And the first question, I'm going to combine two questions together because they're asking on a similar vein. So question from Andrew Johnson, who is a visiting researcher at the Center of Southeast Asian Studies and Alexandra Delfaro graduate student at Cornell University. And from Andrew, I wanted to ask about class and region. These have been such central parts of past protests, but rural and working class protesters have often been more socially conservative, even as they oppose military rule. Has this gap been overcome? How do class and region play into the present day protest movements in terms of rights surrounding gender and sexuality? And then from Alexandra in a very similar way, I wonder if you have a sense of how the protests have been received and may have influenced or inspired people beyond Bangkok. Are protests occurring other places in Thailand aside from urban centers like Bangkok, Chiang Mai, and Khon Kaen, etc.?
Great questions. I think this is really for Rapha.
Okay.
You have a better sense of that.
Actually, the fight for gender equality in the movement right now, we can see it mostly in Bangkok, but we are trying to spread our feminism practice and feminist movement into the region also. Right now we have the section of feminist rebellion in the southern. We have the group in the southern, and also we have the feminist rebellion in the northeast of Thailand also. And northeast northeast is the one of the region that against dictatorship so much, and the main people in the regions we can say they are red shirt, which is against dictatorship also. But I think that the gender equality, the movement of gender equality have to be like more spread, and we are more spreading from the Bangkok, and we are trying with that, especially with the people which is not young, such as red shirt people or okay, which is our ally. they grew up with the gender and heteronormative. So is I think that it has a progress right now because when we see at the protest of the LGBTQ or women, we also see the red shirt there and the red shirt always there, and I think some of the oppression they also get it, like in the latest protest of the Pussy Parade, we talk about the tax on sanitation pad, I guess the red shirt aunt is also associated with that. So I think the as we speak about the gender equality and as we show up as the LGBTQ people as a leader of the protest, it makes the people in the rural or in the region or one which is not familiar with the gender equality or the feminism thing to be more familiar with us and can be our ally to create the gender equality movement. So I guess is there is a progress here in Thailand, and we are trying to spread more of our feminist movement to the region. I think it's a progress, but it's not actually that blooming like in Bangkok.
The next question is from Ajahn Thak, and the question goes as following. The Thai military is very male-centric. So then what is the implication of Rama the 10th putting his queen, concubine, mistresses in command positions of...
Well, I would go back into history and just say that in the past there was a female palace guard who, you know, because only women were allowed in the inner palace, and they were kind of his bodyguards, right? The king's bodyguards. And I bet that if we traced the titles of military ranks into the past, look through Ratchakichanubeksa, you might find that this is not that unusual. But if I'm wrong about that, it would be lovely to know. But I think it's not that unusual to have that in the past. However, today's context is radically different than when absolutism was the way the polity was run. And to have female bodyguards who you're also sleeping with, which is not the case in the past, is just, I think, indicative of a king who can do whatever he wants. So that would be my short answer. Research project, Ajahn Thak.
All right, let's move on to the next question then. The question is from Ajahn Kanchanate Barirak from Northern Illinois University. The question is, how would you and other protesters, so I think I assume the you here is rector, like to define Thai-ness for future generations, given the ways that protesters are actively challenging traditional and established norms of Thai-ness, for example, the three pillars, Cha, Sasana, Pramahakasat.
Okay, I think the Thai-ness which is like Cha, Sasana, Pramahakasat, in the movement sometimes we have tried to reclaim these three pillars. First, chart or the nation, we often say that ชาติคือประชาชน or nation is the people. Before this we can see that the when we talk about nation, it will make us think about the security of the nation. So it's about military, but we have to. I think in my opinion, I like to define the nation to the people, which we have to like care about the people, and the power is to the people, not the military or the monarchy. Second, the religion. Nowadays we can see that some of the monks have joined the protest, have joined the protest and also stand with the people. So one of the things that the monks or and also the people have called for the change is to be the secular state in Thailand, to separate the religion from the state, so we can truly have the freedom to believe what we believe or not to believe in anything. And the third, the monarchy, I think to redefine the monarchy is to reform the monarchy, to have the monarchy under the law, under the constitution, to be a human like us, to get to have less power, and to be under the law like all of us, no less majesty law. So to reclaim or to refine the three pillars of Thainess, I think to redefine like that. First, chart คือประชาชน, nation is the people, ศาสนา, religious is to have a secular state to have a freedom to believe, and third the monarchy, okay, to have the monarchy under the constitution and under the law, so we have to live with each other happily, I guess.
Thank you very much for the answer. I think as we are starting late, we're going to end a little bit later. Sorry for Tamara, I know it's late for you. So we have two more questions. Second to last is a question from Professor Eric White. And the question is, how much and how deeply has the call for gender and sexual egalitarianism permeated the public demands and discourses of non-feminist and non-LGBTQ plus groups and organizations taking part in the current protest?
I'm not sure I can answer that because, again, I haven't been able to go to Thailand for 2 years. So I will let Raptha answer it, but I will only say one thing, and that is the very fact that these images are out there and these protests are happening is already causing a change. There's a permeation that's happening right there. And it might be reactionary for some, but I think it cannot help but have an impact. And that's what I would hope. It'd be interesting to know for sure. So I will turn it over to Raptha.
ถ้าเกิดว่าพี่จำจะช่วยแปลสักนิดหน่อยได้ไหมคะเผื่อว่าจะเข้าใจมากขึ้น
คือเรื่องเกี่ยวกับการเรียกร้องสิทธิเรื่องความเท่าเทียมกันทางเพศต่างๆพวกนี้ครับมันไปอยู่ในข้อเสนอของคนที่ไม่ใช่กลุ่ม LGBTQ หรือไม่ใช่กลุ่มเฟมินิสต์มากน้อยขนาดไหน
I think that the non-feminist and non-LGBTQ people, they didn't talk about the demand like us. They did demand for gender equality. They did demand for marriage equality. But they support us and speak up about the topic themselves, such as Thalufa group, which is led by Pai Dao Din, and he was also arrested in jail. when we working with each other, like when feminist liberate group has a collaboration with Thalu Pha group, we have talking with them about our demands and what feminists are looking for and calling for, or LGBTQ people are calling for, and they understand it. So maybe they didn't show this demand up as their demand, but likely in nowadays they are talking about the gender equality topics and support when we have our own protest, or when we join the protest, they also support us and have and also have speak up about some about the topic with us and supported us. I think so. It might be the answer. I don't know. Maika.
So we have two questions, but the question that just posed by Meredith was, I think he's already been addressed by the previous question. The question was, how on board are cis male non-queer democracy activists with the inclusion and centering of feminist and queer messages, and what strategy or messages most helped that process along? So I think that has already been addressed to a certain extent in the previous question. So I'm sorry, Professor Meredith, I'm going to read the last question from Sene Nguyen from UCLA. And the question is, to the extent that more indigenous elements of protest and resistance can be distinguished from the globalized and transnational, what aspects of the Thai democracy movement, as well as queer and feminist movements in Thailand, are part of more globalized LGBTQ and human rights, women rights discourse, and what aspects are more embedded in local structures and sentiment? Also, in the merging of these three movements, the result of transnational discourses and movements starting to loom larger in these ongoing power negotiations. So I think the main questions about which part is more global, which part is more, and how is the interaction between the two in the current Thai protest?
I might rephrase this a little bit, Dr. I think mostly these questions are for you. And I appreciate the question. I wonder though if can we distinguish between what is global or transnational and what is local anymore? I don't see those as two separate spheres. They're pretty interactive, but I don't want to cut off Rapha because he might have a very precise answer to what they think is Thai about these protests versus what is kind of taken from transnational protests or transnational movements, LGBT movements, women's rights.
ถ้าหนูจะรบกวนพี่แจ่มอีกสักรอบหนึ่งได้ไหมคะ
ได้ครับก็คือคำถามคือประมาณว่าถ้าเราสามารถมองว่ามันมีในมูฟเมนต์ของเราครับมันบางอันหล่อจะบอกได้ว่ามันค่อนข้างจะอินดิจิเนียสหรือค่อนข้างจะเป็นไทยพอสมควรกับบางอันที่มันค่อนข้างจะทรานส์เนชั่นแนลหรือข้ามชาติมากกว่าเช่นเรื่องของการเรียกร้องสิทธิของ LGBTQ เรื่องเกี่ยวกับสิทธิมนุษยชนเรื่องกับสิทธิสตรีเรื่องพวกนี้เราคิดว่าคนถามเขามองว่าค่อนข้างจะเป็นเรื่องที่ transnational หรือ global ทีนี้คำถามก็คือเราพอจะมองเห็นไหมในมุมมองของดร.เนี้ยครับว่าอะไรเป็นอะไรที่ค่อนข้างจะเฉพาะเจาะจงละกันในคือ feminist movement ของไทยตอนนี้ครับมันอาจจะพออธิบายได้ว่ามันมีความเป็นไทยอยู่ธรรมราเมื่อกี้ตอบว่าเราอาจจะแยกไม่ได้ว่าอะไรเป็นไทยหรืออะไรเป็น transnational อย่างเงี้ยครับแต่ว่าธรรมราก็ส่งมาถามแรปเปอร์ว่าเผื่อแรปเปอร์มีคำตอบ
I think that the topic of the oppression of the gender or sexuality is is the global at topics, and it is the experience that we all have faced in internationally, I guess. But I think what the feminist and queer movement in Thailand do, which is indigenous, is our style of protesting. I guess we have used a lot of Thai queer or Thai culture in the protest, such as like I say papayon nang ho tao tak, which is the Thai joke and also Thai like Thai sense of humor to the protest. And we have used some music like the Mo Lam to get into the protest. Mo Lam is the indigenous, I guess, is the northeast of Thailand folk song, which is very very fun and is a part of the culture. So we use kind of this song in the protest, and it show and it against the centralized against the centralized Bangkok, and also is the queer culture that we use in Thai queer culture that we use in the protest. So I think that the topic of equality or oppression is in is global, but we use Thai culture to the protest and to involve more with Thai people, I guess.
Can I add one thing to this? I mean, it's a great question, but another way to flip that question is what we're seeing around the world right now is a rise in authoritarianism. So what is specific about American authoritarianism that we're seeing? What is specific about Thai authoritarianism? What is specific about Filipino authoritarianism, Turkish? You know, and it would be interesting to answer that question, because I do think if we break down what we mean by authoritarianism, you will see that it is very patriarchal across the board. So it's going to generate a similar response. I mean, I think I've been thinking about that a lot, because just like a month ago in China, in the PRC, they banned showing sissy men on television, right? As part of educating people how to be properly masculine. You cannot have effeminate men, like all, you know, the South Korean bands and Jeff stars. So I think that what comes with authoritarianism is a restriction in gender rights, and especially a restriction on women's rights, and also a lack of protections for trans people and for men who don't perform masculinity in a militarized way, right? So we're seeing this in many places, and you do see specifics to each culture. Like in the United States, we have a really strong anti-abortion movement, anti-trans movement, and it probably looks different than what you see in Thailand.
Oh, on that note, thank you very much for an electrifying discussion and the erudite replies to all the challenging questions. As is in Zoom, we have to imagine a thunderous round of applause to both Raptor and Professor Luz. If Sara does not have any other announcement, we'll be officially ending this webinar.
Yes, thank you everyone for joining us, and I appreciate particularly Professor Luz for staying a little bit later, way up in the wilds of Ithaca, New York. So thank you everyone for attending.
Thank you.